Welcome to Lecture 6.6, the Fundamental Theorem of Galois Theory. Let's begin in Paris on May 31st, 1832. This was the final day of Évariste Galois. The night before a duel that he knew he would lose, the 20-year-old stayed up late preparing his mathematical findings in a letter to Auguste Chevalier. Hermann Weyl, a famous mathematician born more than 50 years later, said that this letter, if judged by the novelty and profundity of ideas it contains, is perhaps the most substantial piece of writing in the whole literature of mankind. Now, of course, he's a little bit biased, and I'm sure there are some scholars in literature or philosophy who would love to disagree and argue the statement, but that is neither here nor there. The point is that a 20-year-old kid came up with some of the most impressive mathematical ideas in the whole history of mankind. The crowning achievement of Galois' work is now known as the Fundamental Theorem of Galois Theory. And this is about polynomials with integer coefficients, and it compares the structure of the splitting field of that polynomial, call it big F, and the Galois group of that polynomial, let's call it big G. In particular, it says the following things hold. First, the subgroup lattice of G is identical to the subfield lattice of F, but upside down. And not only is it identical, but the degrees of the extensions in the subfield lattice is the same as the index of the subgroups in G, as we've seen, and as we'll see more examples in this lecture. Moreover, a subgroup H is normal in G if and only if the corresponding subfield is a normal extension of Q. That's something we saw in the previous lecture. Finally, given an intermediate field K, this is something that's bigger than Q but smaller than F, the corresponding subgroup H contains precisely those automorphisms that fix K. So this is something that we'll explain better in the next slide with an explicit example. Let's return to a familiar example which nicely illustrates this so-called Galois correspondence for the polynomial x cubed minus 2. So here on the left is the splitting field of the polynomial, Q adjoins zeta and the cube root of 2, and the subfield lattice. On the right is the Galois group of this polynomial and the subgroup lattice. Notice that these lattices are identical in structure if you turn one of them upside down. And not only is there a bijection between the subfields on the left and the subgroups on the right, as given by the color, but there is also a correspondence between these numbers labeled on the edges. Over here on the left, they correspond to the degrees of the field extensions, and here on the right, they correspond with the indices of the subgroups. So let's go over this in a little more detail, and in particular, let's try to understand the second part of the fundamental theorem of Galois theory, which says that given an intermediate field over here on the left, the corresponding subgroup on the right consists of precisely the automorphisms that fix that subfield. So to begin, let's recall how the Galois group, which consists of six automorphisms, acts on the set of roots of this polynomial. We saw this in the previous lecture. So I will sketch these three roots. So one of them is the third root of 2, the cube root of 2, the real one. And then there is a root up here, which is zeta times the cube root of 2, and a root down here, which is zeta squared times the cube root of 2. So these are the roots of the polynomial. Now the unit circle, recall, is going to be something like this. It's going to be inside of that. So let me color code this. What color do I want to use? Let me use purple because I haven't used that already. So these roots are, of course, at a are 120 degrees apart from each other. And then we have two automorphisms that generate the Galois group. There is the automorphism R, let me write it up here, which takes the cube root of 2 and multiplies it by zeta. So down here in the complex plane, that sends this, or it just rotates everything by 120 degrees. So something like this. So R, I should say, fixes zeta. And again, anything with a cube root of 2 in it, it attaches an extra zeta in front. And then there is the automorphism F, which fixes the cube root of 2. And it sends zeta to its complex conjugate, which is zeta squared. So it sends zeta up here down to zeta squared. And, well, I should say it sends this root to that root. And it would send zeta on the unit circle to its complex conjugate. So these are the automorphisms that generate the Galois group. So D3 is in fact generated by R and F. And now let's go over the subfields on the left and the corresponding subgroups on the right. So let's start with the rational numbers Q, the very bottom here. Now this is a subfield that is fixed by all six automorphisms in the Galois group. So in other words, the set of automorphisms that fix Q is its corresponding subgroup up here. Now let's look at Q adjoined zeta. This is a subfield, and the automorphisms that fix this, I claim, are precisely those in this corresponding subgroup. So this consists of R and R squared and the identity. And notice that R fixes zeta, as does R squared. So this subgroup fixes this subfield. Next, Q adjoined the cube root of 2, this subfield. What fixes that? Well, the cube root of 2 is fixed by F, and so the two automorphisms that fix this subfield is the corresponding subgroup generated by F. Next, let's look at the cube root, Q adjoined zeta times the cube root of 2, this subfield. I claim, I'm not going to check in detail, but I encourage you to do it, that the two automorphisms that fix this subfield are the ones in this corresponding subgroup. We can check it informally. Let's look at zeta times the cube root of 2, that's up here. So how do we fix that? Well, if we do R, that goes down here, and then F, that goes back, then that automorphism fixes this root, and it you can check that it's going to swap these two roots. Next, Q adjoined zeta squared times the cube root of 2, that's the this subfield, I claim, is fixed by R squared F. And let's check. Let's go down here, and let's do R squared F, and we go R squared F, and we get back here. And finally, the automorphisms that fix the entire subfield, well, there's nothing except the trivial automorphism, the identity. So that's precisely the corresponding subgroup down here. So not only do these lattices look the same, but there's more to it than that, is that the correspondence tells us precisely what automorphisms fix which subfields. Finally, recall that the fundamental theorem of Galois theory said even more. It said the normal field extensions here are, remember from the previous lecture, they were Q adjoined zeta, and the entire thing. So you are always going to have these two extensions being trivially normal, just like how you always have these two subgroups being trivially normal. But in this case, we have one more normal field extension. And of course, the normal subgroups of D3 on the right are the two that are always normal, and then this subgroup as well. Now that we have motivated the fundamental theorem of Galois theory, we will spend the remainder of this lecture trying to understand how this implies unsolvability of the quintic, meaning that there are degree 5 polynomials out there whose solutions are not expressible by radicals. To begin, we need an important definition. On the group theory side, we say that a group G is solvable if it has a chain of subgroups, starting with the identity or trivial subgroup, going all the way up to the entire group, such that each quotient of adjacent subgroups is abelian. So Ni mod Ni minus 1 has to be abelian. Now this definition seems completely unmotivated, but as we'll see shortly, the concept of being solvable for a group is going to correspond precisely to a polynomial being solvable by radicals. It is important to understand that each subgroup Ni need not be normal in the entire group. It just has to be normal in the next subgroup. Let's do some examples. Let's begin with D4, which I claim is solvable. There are many possible chains. Here's one to begin. The order of each of these subgroups is a power of 2, because D4 has order 8. So this 1, 2, 4, and 8. And each of these is normal in the next subgroup because it has index 2. Recall that any time we have a subgroup of index 2, it has to be normal. So suppose this is H, and then the complement of H is its unique left coset, other left coset, which is also a right coset. So notice that the subgroup generated by F is not normal in D4, but it is normal in this subgroup. Here's another possible chain of subgroups. The trivial subgroup, of course, is normal in the subgroup generated by R, which is normal in the subgroup or in all of D4. And the order of these, recall, are 1, 4, and 8. In this last chain, the trivial subgroup is normal in this order 2 subgroup, which is normal in D4. Next, any abelian group is trivially solvable. Just take this first subgroup to be trivial, as we always do, and the next subgroup, N1, to be the entire group. So, obviously, this is normal in that, and the quotient is trivially abelian, because the group is abelian. Next, if N is at least 5, then the group AN is simple, meaning it has no normal subgroups other than the trivial subgroup and the entire subgroup, and AN is not abelian. Thus, the only chain of normal subgroups begins with the trivial group and ends one step later with AN. Since the quotient of these groups is isomorphic to AN, which is non-abelian, then AN is not solvable if N is at least 5. Recall on the side of polynomials, polynomials are not solvable by radicals in general if N is at least equal to 5. That is not a coincidence. Also recall that we've seen the alternating group A4, which has 12 elements, and it has a normal subgroup of order 4, so that is not simple. And in fact, it is a solvable group. And on the side of polynomials, well, every polynomial of degree 4 is solvable by radicals. That, too, is not a coincidence, and we'll learn more about this connection in the remainder of the lecture. Here are some more examples of solvable groups. Let's start with D3, which, of course, is isomorphic to S3, is solvable. Now, there's only one chain of subgroups that works, and that's this chain right here. And that's because we can't go up either of these other ways because these subgroups of order 2 are not normal in D3. So this group is barely solvable. On the right is a subgroup. I won't say too much about it. It has order 24, and this is the smallest solvable group that requires a three-step chain of normal subgroups. And so here's the chain right here. Moving on, let's continue our hunt for an unsolvable polynomial of degree 5. Now the following lemma follows from the correspondence theorem, and I want to make sure that you understand why, and I will assist this with pictures. So the lemma says, if N is a normal subgroup of G, actually let me hold on right there, and then I'll come back to this part. So let me remind you what the correspondence theorem says. We have a group G, we have a normal subgroup N, and then we have the trivial subgroup way down here. And the correspondence theorem says that if we look at the subgroup lattice from between N and G, let me draw that like this, then that has the same structure of the subgroup lattice of the quotient G mod N. And the trivial subgroup here is just N mod N. So in other words, these two subgroup lattices have the same structure. Now, of course, the subgroup lattice, the full subgroup lattice of G, you know, there might be other subgroups out here, so I don't know, it might look something like this. There might be other ones here. So let's go back to the lemma. If N is normal in G, well, that just means that we can quotient out by N, then G is solvable if and only if both N is solvable and G mod N are solvable. So the informal proof by picture is, well, what does it mean for G to be solvable? So there has to be a chain of normal subgroups going down to the identity. Well, let me draw this with a, I don't know what color I want to use. Let me draw this with green. So one way that there could be a normal subgroup chain going down to the identity, and recall that that chain has to have certain properties, like the quotient of two consecutive subgroups is abelian. Well, that's not of utmost importance just to understand this general picture. So for there to be a chain from G to the identity, well, we need a chain of subgroups going down to N, and then a chain of subgroups going all the way down to the identity as well. So this lemma says, if we don't have either one of these chains of subgroups, then G is not solvable. Now, when can we have this chain of subgroups going from G to N? Well, that happens precisely when we have a corresponding chain of subgroups going from G mod N to N mod N. And this happens when the quotient is solvable. Next, when do we have a chain going from N down to the trivial subgroup? Well, this chain exists precisely when N is solvable. So this lemma says that we have a chain of subgroups going from G down to the identity with that technicality that we need, if and only if we can get from G to N via such a chain, and then from N to the trivial subgroup. Equivalently, by the correspondence theorem, if and only if we can get from G mod N to N mod N, I mean G mod N is solvable, and we can get from N to the trivial group, i.e. N is solvable. Now this lemma is not 100% clear because, you know, you may be wondering, well, what if G is solvable, but there's some other chain of subgroups that does not go through N, but maybe it goes through some other normal subgroup? Well, that's what this lemma says is not possible, is if we have a normal subgroup, if G is solvable and there's a normal subgroup N, then there is a chain that goes through N. An important corollary of this is that the symmetric group Sn is not solvable as long as N is at least 5. And that's because An is a normal subgroup, which is not solvable. And this corresponds precisely to polynomials are not solvable by radicals as long as N is at least 5. So here's a quick picture of that. So here's Sn, and here's the normal subgroup An, and here's the trivial subgroup. So of course there are tons of subgroups of Sn, and so the full subgroup lattice looks something like this, but this lattice between An and Sn, well, what does that look like? Well, Sn mod An is isomorphic to Z2 because this is an index 2 subgroup. So obviously, Z2 is a solvable group because it is abelian. So this part checks out. However, An, this group here, is not solvable. So there is no chain of subgroups from Sn down to the identity with that technical property of the quotient being abelian because, well, you can get to An, but then you can't get down to the trivial group. Finally, here's the kicker that ties it all together, though I've already told you what it says. Here it is formally. It says, a field extension of the rationals contains only elements that are expressible by radicals if and only if its Galois group is solvable. As a corollary, a polynomial f of x is solvable by radicals if and only if it has a solvable Galois group. And the reason why, stated without proof, is, well, f of x is solvable by radicals if and only if its splitting field, so that is Q adjoined all of its roots, say R1 up to Rn, contains only elements expressible by radicals. And that holds if and only if the Galois group of this field is solvable. And the Galois group of this field is by definition the Galois group of the polynomial. So in other words, the polynomial's Galois group has to be solvable. A corollary of the corollary says that any polynomial whose Galois group is isomorphic to S5, which is not a solvable group, is not solvable by radicals. So to find a polynomial not solvable by radicals, we'll look for a polynomial, f of x, whose Galois group is isomorphic to S5. We'll restrict our search to degree 5 polynomials because we know that the Galois group of a degree 5 polynomial is isomorphic to a subgroup of S5. Here is a key observation about permutations that we will use. Recall from way back that in the symmetric group S5, if we take any 5-cycle sigma and any 2-cycle or transposition tau, then those two elements generate the entire symmetric group. Let's see why this is. Here's a proof by picture, and this holds not just for S5, but for Sn. Let's suppose that we have n people standing in a row. So 1, 2, let's just say 5 people, 3, 4, 5. So a 5-cycle corresponds with cyclically shifting these people. So the last person comes up front, and we get 5, 1, 2, 3, 4. So that's a 5-cycle. And if it's a different 5-cycle, then we can just renumber the people, reorder them. And a 2-cycle, let's just take the 2-cycle 1, 2. That corresponds to having these two people in the front of the line swap places. Now, it should be obvious that I can rearrange these 5 people in any order that I want by some number of cyclic shifts, moving the person at the end of the line to the front, and then swapping the first two people in the line. Hopefully that's clear that I could rearrange these things in any way I want via that 5-cycle and that transposition. And moreover, it does not matter which 5-cycle and which transposition I choose. Another key observation is that the only elements in S5 of order 5 are 5-cycles. Now that's not true for general n. If we have S6, we could have an element 1, 2, and 3, 4, 5. So this element, which has order 6, but it is not a 6-cycle. It's a product of a 2-cycle and a 3-cycle. But in S5, because 5 is prime, the only elements of order 5 are the 5-cycles. Now, here is my polynomial, which I claim will do the trick. X to the fifth plus 10x to the fourth minus 2. It is irreducible by Eisenstein's criterion, just used p equals 2. So 2 divides all of the coefficients except the first one, and 2 squared does not divide the last coefficient. And let's let F be its splitting field. So Q adjoined the five roots of this. Basic calculus, which I will not go over, tells us that F has exactly three real roots. So let's let R1 and R2 be the complex roots. So those are a plus bi and a minus bi. And R3, R4, and R5 be the real roots. Since F has distinct complex conjugate roots, R1 and R2, then complex conjugation is an automorphism of the splitting field that transposes R1 with R2, and it fixes the three real roots. We just found our transposition, tau, which swaps R1 and R2. All that's left to find now is an element, in other words, an automorphism, sigma, of order 5. Let's take any root, Ri, of our polynomial. Since our polynomial is irreducible, it is the minimal polynomial of Ri. By the degree theorem, the degree of the extension of Q adjoined Ri, that single root, is equal to the degree of the minimum polynomial of Ri, which is just 5. The splitting field of f of x is a lot bigger than Q adjoined Ri. It's Q adjoined all of the Ri's. And by the normal extension theorem, the degree of this extension over Q, the degree of this extension over Q, is the order of the Galois group of f. Now, we can apply the tower law. So we begin with the order of the Galois group of f, which is equal to the degree of the splitting field of f over Q. And now, by the tower law, that is the product of the degree of the splitting field over Q adjoined R1. Remember, I said take any root Ri, so I'm just taking R1. Times the degree of Q adjoined R1 over Q, which we just set up here, we know is equal to 5. Thus, the order of the Galois group is a multiple of 5. That's all we could say from this. It's some multiple of 5. And so Cauchy's theorem guarantees that, let's call this group G, has an element sigma of order 5. Since the Galois group has a 2-cycle tau and a 5-cycle sigma, it must be all of S5. Therefore, the Galois group of F is an unsolvable group, it's isomorphic to S5, and therefore, this polynomial is unsolvable by radicals. And that is how Galois, as a teenager, invented the concept of a group to prove a long-standing open question about unsolvability of the quintic, a seemingly unrelated area of mathematics. So let's summarize his work. Let's let f of x be a degree n polynomial with integer coefficients, or if you prefer, with rational coefficients. Well, in that case, the roots of this polynomial lie in some splitting field, f of q. The Galois group of this polynomial, by definition, is the automorphism group of f. It's the automorphism group of the splitting field. Every such automorphism fixes the rationals, Q, and permutes the roots of F. This is a group action of the Galois group on the set of N roots. Therefore, the Galois group of F of X is a subgroup of Sn. Next, there's this important one-to-one correspondence between subfields of the splitting field, and subgroups of the Galois group. Galois proved that a polynomial is solvable by radicals if and only if its Galois group is a solvable group. And he invented not only this technical definition of solvable group, but actually the entire concept of a group in order to prove this. The symmetric group S5 is not a solvable group. However, S5 is generated by any 2-cycle and any 5-cycle, so all we need to do is find a degree 5 polynomial whose Galois group contains a 2-cycle, meaning an automorphism that swaps 2 roots and fixes the other 3, and an element of order 5, which has to be a 5-cycle, meaning it cyclically shifts or permutes those 5 roots. If f of x is an irreducible degree 5 polynomial with 3 real roots, then complex conjugation is an automorphism that transposes the 2 complex roots. Moreover, Cauchy's theorem tells us that the Galois group must have an element of order 5, which has to be a 5-cycle. Therefore, any irreducible degree 5 polynomial with 3 real roots, for example, x to the 5th plus 10x to the 4th minus 2, is not solvable by radicals. Hopefully, this should leave you utterly impressed with the power of group theory to seemingly unrelated problems in the world of pure mathematics.